Hey everyone, so it's been a while since I've done an FGC focus video, and that's because two things really. One, you know, there hasn't been that many events until recently now with online tournaments, and I've been doing short little recap videos for the Pro Tour. Let me know if you enjoy content like that. And aside from that, I think a lot of FGC content creators have really stepped up now that, you know, they can't go to events. There's been lots of streams, lots of reactions, lots of commentary. And speaking of commentary, there was an event this weekend which I want to talk about, which was the Japanese FGC panel. They had a bunch of producers from different series and titles and publishers all do kind of like a roundtable discussion. And the feedback online has mostly been, I would say, maybe disappointment, because they didn't really talk about the hot button topics that really dominate like the FGC Twitter sphere, you know, which is like netcode and stuff. And I understand that, because, you know, that's kind of impossible. You know, you're not going to have a bunch of publishers and their PR teams agree to talk about the failings of their games amongst their competitors. It's just unrealistic. I mean, the idea that, you know, all these publishers had their producers talk, you know, fairly freely, and they broadcasted it on their own publisher-owned channels, and they allowed announcements and IPs to promote their stuff, like the fact that Capcom was airing a trailer announcing a new Soul Calibur character, like, it's kind of crazy that this happened at all. So what I kind of wanted to talk about was some of the things they brought up and what I thought was interesting that came out of the panel, and, you know, what it could mean for, you know, some of the future developments in the FGC. But before I get into that main topic, I do think that we should show some appreciation towards events like Evo, GameStart Asia, and Red Bull Kumite, because they have shown that these FGC events can be legitimate marketing activations for these companies, and these are the events that these companies should be targeting, right? Because they've traditionally saved all their media and big announcements for the traditional games media stuff like E3 or PAX, and now they go to these events and the producers are treated like rock stars. There's lots more engagement, so I think this is good for the future of the FGC in general. So hopefully the developers had a good experience. You know, maybe they avoided the wave of criticism that pops up immediately online, and they look at the appreciation that comes out of it, because the more they feel comfortable coming to these events or having these discussions, you know, the more access we as fans and the more actual opportunities we get to give our feedback, so that hopefully some of those, you know, wish lists like netcode actually make it into development and get worked on. So I do want to say I'm not really going to talk about any of the character reveals or content announcements for the games, because, I mean, I feel like there are people who are way better and have way more hype and bring in the reactions and opinions on that kind of stuff. And without further ado, let's get into it. So the first topic is netcode. Everyone wanted to hear about netcode. And, you know, this was really danced around. I think you heard Rollback mentioned once or twice. What was discussed was crossplay and matchmaking, and crossplay was actually discussed to a fair degree in terms of the challenges that it faced, but almost all the developers agreed that it was important to try and achieve crossplay between the consoles and PC for the future, because when you have the player bases segregated, you know, if you can't find matches online, and this was really important with matchmaking, is that, you know, you not only want to consistently find players to play against, but you want matchmaking to be done in a way where you're playing people that are of the same level as you. Like, you don't want to go online and get destroyed if you're a newbie. You want to play other newbies and slowly inch and get better so you keep playing. And I thought this was really interesting. I also thought it was interesting that, you know, Harada had basically mentioned that he had done a lot of the research and he had made presentations to the first party companies, you know, Xbox and Sony, about achieving crossplay, and they all sounded excited, but then nothing was ever done. So, you know, here's hoping with the next generation of consoles. Unfortunately, you know, there still is competition. So I know it was a big struggle for Fortnite to get this done, but hopefully crossplay is something that happens, because, you know, you really need as many fighting game players to be able to play and play against each other online for the community to not only get better, but also grow. So I do agree with them that getting crossplay, hopefully into the next gen, is something that's achievable, because I do think it's really important. So the other thing that was discussed at length, and this was also something that kind of tiptoed around the whole, you know, netcode discussion, which was improving AI in fighting games. So AI in fighting games, if you think about it, like in old school games, basically the harder the difficulty, the computer just read your inputs and reacted to it. And in newer games, like the AI tries to be realistic, but basically, you know, you just figure out a way to game the system and it's really easy to defeat even at the hardest difficulties once you understand how fighting game mechanics work. So the thinking was, is that if you could create an AI that seemed realistic or seems human and can play at different levels, this will be beneficial for bringing new players into the game and keeping them in the game. Because if you think about it, right, like the whole thing was around matchmaking. Like if you can't find opponents, then you probably won't keep playing. And the problem is that if someone's watching, say, Capcom Cup, right, and, you know, we're year five into Street Fighter V, they watch Capcom Cup or they watch Evo and they get hype and they want to go play the game, they go jump online, maybe they get matched up with someone just mashing, but most likely they're going to get matched up with someone who has a lot of experience already, because, you know, the player base tends to dwindle the longer the games are out, and they're just going to get destroyed back to back to back, and they're not going to want to play anymore. So having basically AI bots, right, and AI bots that recognize the player's skill level, and the player, as long as the player doesn't know that it's a bot, they feel like they're beating someone that's real, like it's going to motivate them to keep playing, and they slowly get better and better and better. And I think this is a really cool idea, because I remember when I used to play Street Fighter 4, I played it with my cousin, and at the time I was far better than my cousin, right? But I quickly saw that if I just destroyed him in the game, he just did not want to play anymore. But if I gave him a tip, like if I taught him how to, you know, option select crouch tech, you know, he would spam it. But if I just let him get those throws or, you know, light kick me out of it, you know, he would get excited that he learned something and he would keep playing me. And if I let him beat me and just threw new things his way and explained to him, like, this is how you beat this, this is how you beat that, and then let him beat me with those things that I taught him, you know, he kept playing and we had a lot of fun. So I do think it's important that, you know, fighting games, especially fighting games that are further into their lifespan, you know, they're really newbie unfriendly. Like if you think of other genres, like almost any shooting game, it doesn't matter how old the shooting game is, especially if it's like a battle royale, you can just jump in the game, and if you sneak up on someone, you can get a few kills, exhilarating, and you still want to keep playing. Whereas with fighting games, you know, if someone's like, hey, you like Street Fighter? Yeah, I like Street Fighter. Been playing it for years. You're going to have no fun playing against that person unless they take it easy on you. And I know this goes against the whole competitive mindset, but, you know, one of the most important things that they discussed and was said that was important, you know, from the bosses and, you know, the money man, was you not only have to maintain your existing audience, but you have to get a new audience. And, you know, getting a new audience is possible with graphics and stuff, but if they're not have fun playing the games, they never become that hardcore fan that's going to keep, you know, dumping money into the game series. So I thought the idea of AI was cool. Like I remember Virtual Fighter had this quest mode, and you went to different arcades and you fought AIs, and like some of the AIs were supposedly based on existing arcade players. So like, you know, I wasn't able to play the game online, but when I played against one of those, you know, ghost AIs, I felt like, okay, I could probably match up against a real good player. It's that kind of like positive reinforcement. And that's with me knowing that it was just a CPU. So if I felt that I was playing a human opponent and I beat them, I'd be like, oh yeah, you know, I'm getting better at this game. I'm going to keep plugging away at it. And I don't get so, you know, demoralized when I defeat someone that, you know, I feel is maybe a little bit higher than me, but like I can achieve that goal. So I think probably the only disappointing part of the panel for me, or the roundtable, was that one of the more interesting discussion points was kind of cut short because some of the other topics went on too long. And this is the perceived oversimplification of fighting games, or the dumbing down of fighting games. And, you know, one of the initial things said was that the reason why, you know, this is done is because, you know, they're tasked with not only maintaining the hardcore audience, which honestly is really going to play any iteration of a fighting game, especially the franchises that they like, but to also bring in a new audience and bring in new customers. So, you know, one of the things that, you know, definitely has been thought of is like, is fighting games too hard? And their approach to making fighting games easier or dumbing them down is not really dumbing them down, but making them easier in the sense of easier to understand what's going on. And it was mentioned that the way this is trying to be accomplished is by, you know, UI and UX. So if we take the UI part, right, this is like the look of something, right? How you, you know, are going to interact with it. And you know, one of the easy ways to accomplish this is to give things that look interesting, right? So, you know, super move. So let's take one move, for example, right? Like, you see Ken's flaming dragon punch for the first time and it looks super cool and you want to know how to do that. So you learn inputs and you learn how to do special moves, but that's not the only thing you need to learn. You need to learn like when to use it. When is it appropriate? Because as soon as you learn Ken's dragon punch, you're probably going to throw it out like crazy and maybe you hit it a couple times, but all of a sudden you're dying because that's all you're using. So, you know, it has to teach you that Ken's dragon punch is something that leaves you very vulnerable. It's like throwing a haymaker. So that's the UI aspect of things. So when it comes to the UX type of things, right, you need to think about the things that keeps players playing, you know, keeps the experience enjoyable for them. So, you know, for hardcore players, they're going to want a challenging experience. Like, they know what they want out of fighting games. So there's not necessarily that much work to be done with them. They want, you know, a system that's deep, like maybe, you know, easy to pick up, but hard to master. And on the other side, you have to think of the UX for new players. Like, they have no idea of any of these fighting game concepts like footsies and spacing. You know, they just maybe learn how to do a couple special moves. And I think this probably showcases one of the greatest shortcomings with fighting games, which is education, right? And I know we have a ton of tutorials and guides out there, but the problem is that, you know, we really teach people the wrong things, right? Like, what is the first thing you get out of a fighting game? Is you get, you know, like tutorials on how to do a combo, like a simple basic combo. But if you learn how to do that combo and then you go online and you see the same thing, you see some tech that you don't understand being done or some crazy combo that always starts with a jump in, or, you know, here's an infinite combo. You really get taught combos first in fighting games, or, you know, the inputs. And the thing is that it doesn't matter what combo you learn. If you don't know how to create the situation to go into that combo, you're never going to enjoy fighting games. Like, I remember when I first started playing Street Fighter 4, you know, I learned the basic combo for Balrog, which is, you know, jab, jab, short, headbutt into ultra if I had it. And the thing was, is that I never learned what focus attack was for a long time. So if all I know is how to do dash punch and headbutt and jabs, but I don't know what focus attack is or does, both me as a player, I don't know how to use it, and I don't know how to deal with it when the other player is doing it. You know, especially with Balrog, like, I died. I didn't know about throws or armor breaking moves. I didn't know how to beat that move or how to create the situations to be able to use my combo. So I definitely think that's a challenge of user experience with fighting games that needs to be tackled, is that we need to better teach players, you know, how you play with the fighting game. You know, a lot of other games kind of have it easy. You know, a shooter is very much to the point. You know, you shoot someone with a gun. Now there's a ton of more depth behind that, and if you really want to get to the top tier, you have to do it. But already getting that notion of success and that you're doing something right is very obvious in shooting games. Knowing what you did right in fighting games is very difficult, and I do think that it was really good that they talked about this, and I think this is something that's going to be really important in the future if you want to have those tournaments, right? Every new game you see comes out, it's always the same thing with the tournament. First 2 weeks, there's 100 plus more. It's the biggest turnout ever for any new game. Then a few weeks later, it's back down at the level it was before, or even below, because all those people came in, they got destroyed. No one gave them any feedback on what happened, what they did wrong. They probably were beating up the CPU. They thought they were really good. They blazed through story mode, and then they got into a match against a real player and they had no idea what was going on. And a lot of times, you know, people tell you that you need to ask people, how did you beat me or what happened? But that's really intimidating at your first tournament. So at one level, it's on the community's end to be more welcoming and inviting and proactive in teaching these players what to do. But yeah, also on the game developer side, they need to create better tools, teach people how to actually play fighting games. Anyway, what did you think of the real FGC Illuminati panel? Were you spamming emojis and ASIC art until you got banned? Did you ignore everything thinking that it was a Tekken 8 waiting room? Or, you know, did you think what the FGC developers discussed and what I discussed is actually going to be important to the future of fighting games? What do you think is actually important you know, aside from just netcode. Let me know in the comments, give a like if this video was interesting or helpful, and subscribe if you too also wish that Harada was your uncle that showed up to birthday parties and told funny jokes and entertained anyone. Anyway, thanks again for watching. Catch you on the next one.